This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google.
Editorial Introduction. Austin Sarat and Thomas R. Kearns.
Legal scholarship and law itself is undergoing one of those occasional periods of rupture in which traditional assumptions no longer seem adequate or satisfactory. Law is said to be turning outward in search of new grounding. Legal scholarship seems to be undergoing a rapid rotation in which attempts are made to accommodate the contradictory and conflicting challenges of deontological liberalism, natural law, pragmatism, interpretive social science, economics, and several varieties of critical social theory. Some of those challenges are regarded as potent enough to distort the purposes of law and threaten its very existence. Others promise a way of thinking that will provide new rationality and coherence for legal decisions. And even if one resists such apocalyptic or utopian visions, it seems safe to say that not since the emergence of legal realism more than 60 years ago has there been both so much doubt and uncertainty and so much excitement and widespread interest in what is happening in the legal world. While contemporary critiques of law are as diverse as they are numerous, no one would deny that feminist and post-structuralist writings are among the most wide-ranging and provocative. In this book, we ask about the fate of law in light of these two genres of contemporary critical thought. Because both feminism and post-structuralism had their genesis outside of legal scholarship, each asks us to think about the fate of law in light of cultural ferment, the reach of which goes far beyond law itself. It is from these large perspectives that the five original essays presented in this book hope to glimpse law's fate. But even with this wide angle of vision, our interest in this volume is not to achieve systematic statements of feminist or post-structuralist thought about law. Programmatic statements presenting the variety of feminist and post-structuralist criticisms of law can be found elsewhere. We invite contemplation about how, if at all, law and legal scholarship have responded or should respond to feminist and post-structuralist challenges, to claims about law's neutrality, objectivity, and capacity to limit and channel the exercise of power in American life. Here we seek to assess just how seriously the challenges posed in each of these critical approaches should be taken, and to draw out the lessons of such critical positions for law itself. A unifying feature of the essays collected in this volume is that they all reject, or at least seriously question, claims of neutrality or objectivity in law and legal theory. They each manifest a belief that feminism and/or post-structuralist criticism of law has moved law and legal scholarship beyond an unproblematic and confident embrace of reason and rationality. They differ, however, in their assessment of the significance of that movement and in their understandings of how law has, and ought to, moved in response. Some see feminism and post-structuralism as having a disruptive and transformative influence on law, opening up new possibilities. Others see greater resistance and resilience in current legal arrangements. The bulk of mainstream legal scholarship has tended to view contemporary critiques of law, like those included in the Fate of Law, through the same lens through which it once surveyed the revolution of legal realism. There are, no doubt, some important resemblances. First, like the legal realists, many of today's critics are quite skeptical about the power and efficacy of legal rules, especially as devices to tie down the world, to determine cases in advance, and to eliminate discretionary judgment and politics from law. And again, like yesterday's legal realists, today's critics display the exuberance of those who see themselves as participating in an intellectual revolution. Traditionalists in law and legal theory respond to these affinities with legal realism in a variety of ways. Some apparently believe, or perhaps they just hope, that there is nothing more in the new criticism than a warmed-over realism that will, in time, run its course. But others find reason, echoing the response of an earlier generation, to denounce contemporary challenges to law as reckless or nihilistic. References to realism provide an instructive frame for a reading of the essays in The Fate of Law. Those essays suggest, in fact, that similarities between today's critique of law and legal realism are both greater and less than many traditionalist responses suppose. Thus, it is important to see that today's critics are often vastly more thoroughgoing than were most of the realists in disavowing Enlightenment assumptions about the capacity of reason and science to guide social progress. Most pointedly, today's critics almost universally reject the optimism of many realist thinkers regarding the power of the social sciences to provide law with neutral and objective groundings. Contemporary thinkers are inclined to extend their doubts about law to the social sciences themselves, and have noted, among other things, the ways in which law already constitutes much of the world that those disciplines attempt to study. They conclude that this entanglement makes social science problematic as a grounding for law and legal decisions. While several of the contributors to The Fate of Law exemplify this skepticism, they offer no uniform replacement for the realist embrace of social science. Their challenge to social science is only a symptom of a more pervasive epistemological doubt that, when extended to law, reveals a conviction that law lacks any compelling formal grounding. On the other hand, the contributions to this book would appear to refute any claim that today's critics are inescapably unconstructive or nihilistic. Asked to contemplate the fate of law in a world in which Enlightenment faith in reason and science has eroded, the authors whose work is presented in The Fate of Law have offered accounts and imaginings of law and law's fate that are distinctly, though diversely, engaged with reconstruction as well as criticism. Theirs is neither a message of despair nor a rejection of law tout court. On the contrary, some explore alternative ways of grounding law by reconceiving law itself. Others identify external standards for law grounded in local practices and particular social narratives. It appears, then, that the abandonment of Enlightenment ideals and realist optimism about social science need not end in dire predictions about the death of law. Nowhere in these essays is there any suggestion that the relentless skepticism of the past decade foreshadows the end of law. Instead, while law's fate and the fate of legal scholarship appear unsettled, that is, not fated, and moving in a variety of directions, this is taken as a positive sign and an opportunity for reconsideration of law and law's relation to the social world. While each of the essays contributes to the critique of law, each seems fully accepting of law in some form, and hopeful, if not confident, that law can and should be reimagined, reconfigured, and rescued. Yet the constructive visions displayed in the essays do not display the homogeneity of, say, the realists' program. Rather, they exhibit a familiar feature of contemporary critical debate about law, namely, even in its most constructive mood, it tends to be characterized by diversity, by a pluralism of voices and viewpoints, and by differing, even warring, perspectives. Such diversity, pluralism, and difference contributes greatly to the excitement stirred by contemporary legal scholarship, but prevents us from putting together an anthology that is at once representative and reasonably brief. Thus, The Fate of Law is not a catalog or a comprehensive account of previously worked out positions. The essays contained in this book do not present the full range of views an encyclopedic treatment would require. Each of these essays speaks in its own voice, each confronts important contemporary developments in law and legal scholarship and locates them in relation to feminism and or post-structuralism. However, the tone and style of the essays is by no means uniform. They display the unique intensities and passions of their authors. They range from broad and abstract historical and philosophical analyses to close readings of legal cases. Readers may find this tonal and stylistic pluralism jarring, but we think that one of the strongest themes of both feminist and post-structuralist writing is its openness, diversity, and impatience with uniformity. Thus, as editors, we have not tried to discipline the essay's style or homogenize their tone. Each speaks for itself and explores the fate of law in its own way. We begin with Martha Minow's Partial Justice, Law and Minorities. Minow asks why, at this moment, we are worrying about the fate of law, and responds by providing a comprehensive overview of what she argues are sea changes in the basic, taken-for-granted assumptions that provide coherence in our culture. Minow notes that such changes are reflected, first, in shifts in the alignments and coalitions among groups fighting over issues of the day, and second, in broad philosophical contests over the meaning and status of reason itself. She illustrates the first by discussing feminist debates about pregnancy and maternity leave benefits, as well as comparable worth. Here, Minow describes deep divisions within the feminist community that, in her view, reflect differences over what law is or could be. She also sees those divisions at work in debates and arguments within jurisprudence about basic concepts in theories of law, such as rights and the rule of law. However, Minow does not seek to reconstruct jurisprudence. Instead, she advocates storytelling as a way of making sense of the changes, divisions, and debates that she has cataloged. One such story is a broad, sweeping narrative of the evolution of theories of knowledge, a story that Minow variously labels a challenge to authority, and the insider story. A second story, labeled the outsider story, focuses on the experiences of women, children, members of racial and religious minorities, and disabled persons. Minow argues that developments within the insider story barely reach the outsiders, or, when they do, they further marginalize outsiders or complicate their efforts at resistance and reconstruction. Post-structuralism, Minow argues, is the latest variety of the insider story, and it too poses difficulties for the efforts of outsiders to gain a voice within law by calling into question their efforts to develop coherent selves and coherent identities. She sees many points of tension between post-structuralism and feminism and believes that they push law in different directions. Post-structuralism focuses on the indeterminacy of legal language and the critique of rights, while the outsider's story, as illustrated by feminist and minority scholars, pays attention to the disadvantages that law imposes on particular groups in particular contexts. Minow identifies herself with the outsider's story because of its insistence upon the partiality of all stories. It is this emphasis on partiality and the embrace of the skepticism and openness it invites that Minow thinks is the appropriate response of legal scholars to the various stories she tells. She urges us to recognize law as a set of practices and institutions situated within more than one narrative of human history, to embrace a theory of law that is pluralist, heterogeneous, and localist, and to think about the fate of law by examining actual problems as defined and experienced by the people living through them. In the next essay, Bovantra de Souza Santos argues that the kind of pluralism, heterogeneity, and localism that Minow advocates is, in fact, on the horizon as law goes through what he calls the postmodern transition. Santos attends to the material and structural conditions that make possible the transformation of law during this period of transition. He sees and describes a logical progression in capitalist political economy that provides, in his view, the backdrop for developments in critical social thought about law. The progression of capitalist development and the emergence of critical social thought about law provide the impetus for the kind of reconstruction of legality that both he and Minow envision. Santos argues that we are witnessing the exhaustion of what he calls the paradigm of modernity, an exhaustion brought about both by the successful completion of some of the projects of modernity and the recognition that modernity is no longer capable of fulfilling some of its other projects. Modernity, as Santos sees it, is a historical period whose point of origin Santos places in the 16th century. The emergence of the modern is seen in the development of new forms of regulation, in particular, the state, and new resources for emancipation. Santos identifies rationality and rationalism as central to the emancipatory processes of modernity. He describes how the regulatory and emancipatory impulses of modernity take shape through three periods of capitalist development, and argues that the exhaustion of modernity results from both its ambitions and its internal contradictions. For Santos, it is the exhaustion of modernity that makes possible the transformation of law. He identifies this transformation with a process of decentering and pluralizing power, which in turn makes possible the reinvention of what he calls mini-rationalities, freed from any totalizing discourse. Santos locates this decentering and pluralization in the history of ideas and associates it with the critique of foundationalist epistemologies and a revived interest in rhetoric and pragmatism. He argues, in addition, that the decentering and pluralization of power arise in part from the inability of the modern legal form to address some of the serious problems of our age, from Chernobyl to AIDS. The response to the exhaustion of modernity, in his view, is not to be found in the formulation of another philosophy, but in the effort to identify emancipatory everyday practices. Santos describes the exhaustion of modernity as the social condition necessary to allow for the proliferation of political and legal interpretive communities of the kind that Minow advocates. This development will, in his view, result in a controlled dispersal of law, the trivialization of state law, and the growth of what he calls a new legal minimalism. In this new world of postmodern legality, the limits of social transformation through law will become more apparent, and other forms of emancipatory practice will emerge. While Santos is hopeful about the liberation and liberalization of law, Robin West in Disciplines, Subjectivities, and Law is much less optimistic. Feminism and post-structuralism go a long way toward undermining faith in the Enlightenment version of reason and rationality. Yet she asks whether and how we can criticize law, if not by reference to reason, by which is meant either categorical moral truths divined by pure reason, or, alternatively, a theory of the good, in turn, grounded in universal but concrete truths about human nature, derived through rational methods of empirical inquiry. Her essay discusses three responses to this question. The first is what she calls legal authoritarianism. For the vast majority of mainstream legal scholars, the question West poses, the question posed by a serious engagement with feminism and postmodernism, is oddly irrelevant. For them, reason has never been the standard against which particular laws should be judged. For most legal scholars, West contends, it is law itself that provides the standard. Any particular law is evaluated against law's own internal critical and normative apparatus. If feminism and post-structuralism have any relevance to mainstream legal scholars, it is to reinforce legal authoritarianism by providing a sophisticated skepticism that philosophical studies and empirical science have nothing normative to offer. The critique of reason thus paradoxically reinforces the conservatism and self-referential quality of mainstream legal discourse. At the same time, West identifies a neo-pragmatist response within the mainstream legal academy, exemplified by the work of Stanley Fish, whose essay follows West's, that takes the post-structuralist critique of reason seriously and concludes, in light of that critique, that there is no choice but to judge one act of power in light of another. Next, West considers the response of two interdisciplinary movements in legal scholarship, law and economics, and law and humanities. Both represent efforts which West thinks have largely failed to find normative standards external to law itself. West tells a story of parallel development in what are generally thought of as two dissimilar intellectual movements. Development, in which an initial critical impulse is domesticated as scholars confront the limits of reason. For law and economics, the inability to know subjective preferences and tastes leads to the substitution of expressed consumer preferences and wealth maximization as the standard of judgment that is offered to law. West contends that this substitution means that what law and economics offers is itself already constituted by the prevailing patterns of power in society. Thus, law and economics, like mainstream legal scholarship, ends up judging one set of power relations, law, by another. For the law and humanities scholar, the inability rationally to apprehend communal well-being or happiness functions analogously to the economist's inability to know subjective preferences. Because of this alleged defect or inadequacy of reason, the humanist substitutes participation in interpretive communities or in the explication of canonical texts as the measure of value that law should advance. West argues that, for the humanist, the test of law is its capacity to create values that accord with those represented in the literary canon or that create the conditions necessary for interpretive community. Yet it is circular, West argues, to criticize law by reference to the values of great texts, since the greatness of a text is a product of similar operations of social power to those that produce law itself. As a result, the law and humanities movement ends up, because of its disillusionment with reason itself, criticizing one effect of power in light of another. To end the circularity that West sees in these responses to the question of how to evaluate or criticize law from an external point of view, we must re-examine the possibility of knowing subjective states and community well-being by questioning rationality as a standard of knowledge. West claims that irrational knowledge, in particular what she calls sympathy, can provide a standard for judging law. For her, the response to feminist and post-structuralist critiques of reason is to liberate us from reason itself and to discover a new source of inspiration for law and legal decisions. These critiques do not diminish law or render it more plural and partial. They open up the possibility of a transformation that is widespread and all-encompassing. In contrast to West's suggestion that law can and should be transformed from the outside by being made responsive to the politics and struggles of the heart, Stanley Fish argues that law, in order to be law, must be insulated and unresponsive. In his judgment, feminism and post-structuralism help us see the partiality and indeterminacy, the inconsistencies and contradictions in legal discourse. Such critical specification of what law is reveals elements seemingly external to law that are already incorporated within legal discourse. For Fish, the rhetorical practices of law are self-generating and self-perpetuating. Law, like any other practice, is, in his view, largely impervious to theory and external criticism. Thus, it succeeds in having a formal existence. Both feminism and post-structuralism are incorrect in assuming that law has been or could be some other way. As Fish sees it, the law wishes to have a formal existence and is rhetorically resilient in maintaining its formalism. Law assimilates extra-legal concerns into its own categories and, as a result, is able to fashion an autonomy out of the very material it then rhetorically pushes away in the name of that autonomy. Law's fate is to continue to maintain itself through ever more ingenious rhetorical ploys. It has not been derailed, nor does he believe it will be derailed by critical exegesis. Fish argues that there are two major threats to law's autonomy, to its ability to maintain its formalism. The first is morality, the second is interpretation. While Fish treats these threats separately, he believes that they pose essentially the same threat, that is, to reduce law to merely an effect of something outside itself. Fish examines two doctrines in contract law, the parole evidence rule and consideration, the first to reveal how law both repels and incorporates interpretation, the second to provide a similar analysis of the relationship of law and morality. The law incorporates interpretation and morality, and at the same time denies that it is doing so. As Fish argues, to be efficacious, law's formalism must be the product of and responsive to the very forces that its formalism is meant to hold in check. Law, he says, creates itself out of the very materials that it is obliged to push away. This inconsistency is hardly the critical flaw assumed in many contemporary critiques. It is, in Fish's view, a mark of law's amazing success. For Fish, law's formality and its autonomy are largely rhetorical. Law's rhetoric works to tell two stories at once, to tell two stories as if they were one. Inconsistency and irrationality in doctrine are what enable law to do its work. Law, Fish proclaims, is thoroughly rhetorical and always engaged in effacing its rhetoric. He urges his readers to pay attention to the conditions under which law's rhetorical duality, its capacity to be what it denies and incorporate what it seeks to expel, succeeds. As Fish contends, it may be necessary to focus on law's rhetorical powers if we are to understand its resistance to critical attack and its remarkable capacity to employ linguistic and interpretive devices to absorb and deflect external challenges. In A Journey Through Forgetting, Toward a Jurisprudence of Violence, Sarat and Kearns do not deny law's rhetorical virtuosity when they contend that contemporary mainstream and critical jurisprudence appear to be on the verge of forgetting that law is not merely a matter of words, but is centrally involved in the social organization of violence. Law does not merely curtail violence, it also inflicts pain and death. Far from denying law's rhetorical powers, this essay might be read as providing disturbing proof of those powers. It explores how law and legal theory have managed to focus attention on the necessity of law's violence as a response to the violence outside law, and, miraculously, have also managed to expunge law's own violence from the pages of legal texts and the minds of legal scholars. It is difficult to imagine a more thoroughgoing display of rhetorical power than this concealment of law's violence. According to its own story, law appears to be immersed in the bloody business of violence, yet the day-to-day texts of law are quite bloodless, unstained by, and seemingly oblivious to the sordid business at hand. Sarat and Kearns retrace what they call law's official story as it unfolds in the canon, in Hobbes, Austin, Hart, and Dworkin, as well as in contemporary critiques, in an effort to illuminate the steps by which law's violence has become nearly invisible in legal scholarship. They uncover a persistent and pervasive concern with law's alleged affinities with reason and rationality, that, especially in the canon, displaces and distances Law's violent nature. This preoccupation is plainly challenged in contemporary critiques that deftly disclose the violence of legal interpretation and encourage a clear-headed appreciation of Law's rhetorical and interpretive resourcefulness. But these critiques, too, leave the story of the way rhetoric and interpretation become pain and death largely untold. Thus, Sarat and Kearns suggest that a further step is required, namely a retelling of Law's story that resists, or at least holds off, our desire to believe that Law's violence is somehow different from ordinary numbing force. Such a story would resist, too, the congenial notion that Law's violence can be tamed by reason. Whether it is possible to tell a story that bridges the gap in Law's pretensions, between its appeals to reason and its reliance on force, and also links interpretive violence with pain and death, would appear to be the central issue facing a jurisprudence of violence. It is impossible to discern whether the response to feminist and post-structuralist criticism of Law will be a reconstructed legality or a legal order ever more resilient in its capacity to resist radical transformation. Moreover, attempting to discern the pattern of Law's response is somewhat odd, especially when it is tied to the question of the fate of Law. Such a title seems to suggest the calm measure of detached Enlightenment reason, of teleology, of scientific rationalism, even of prediction, from which each of the essays in this book seeks to distance itself. But perhaps we can read our own title differently, and advance by retreating to an earlier view in which fate had more mystical associations, and in which to talk of fate was to engage in a telling of the past rather than a prediction of the future, to try to unravel promises already made, decisions already arrived at, or a destiny already sealed. Perhaps the fate of Law is not to play the hero in a melodrama written by Thrasymachus or Hobbes. Perhaps we will come to see that the feminist and post-structuralist critique of Law is part of its reconstruction and continuous revitalization. Perhaps it is the ironic fate of Law to be reconstructed or revitalized by those very ideas, for example, compassion, engagement, even politics, that Law has for so long tried to exclude. To talk about the fate of Law in this way is not to bemoan the tragedy of the modern condition, the iron cage of a depleted Weberian rationalism. It is to witness the rescue of the modern condition from itself. Or perhaps Law's fate is neither so well settled nor so precarious as we might imagine from time to time. Each of the essays in this book claims or implies that Law's fate is substantially undetermined. They explore contingent possibilities rather than describe fixed routes of resistance or change. This suggests that Law's fate may be no more fixed than a Sisyphean reconstruction and revitalization in reaction to changes in the practices and beliefs on which Law depends. But one thing seems clear. Law's fate is neither so well settled nor so precarious as to make further discussion of that fate either unnecessary or impossible.
Partial Justice, Law and Minorities. Martha Minow.
I was surprised and delighted to be asked to speak on the topic, the fate of Law. I was surprised because this strikes me as a tall person's topic, a topic for someone who can survey the entire world of law and comment on its overall development. To discuss the fate of law is an invitation to make statements that cast shadows. My work tends to look at the margins and corners, especially at people such as women, children, and persons with disabilities. I am interested in people who have not been the central subjects of theories of law, people who have lived in law's shadows. At the same time, I was delighted to be asked to speak on the fate of law because the invitation gave me permission to stop and ask, what do contemporary developments in jurisprudence mean for people who historically have been marginalized by law and legal theory? Do their experiences and perspectives register in contemporary theoretical debates? Do emerging lines of theory offer avenues for reordering law to include those who have been excluded or subordinated? These questions interest me, and I will take this chance to address them. Still, I confess a worry that the topic, the fate of law, presents a trap. It implies that something has changed, something is new, and some danger has appeared in the life of the law. It implies an imagined life cycle for law, a birth, youth, and maturity, and perhaps a decline toward death. Law's fate conveys a greater sense of frailty or speculated limits than, say, law's empire. Moreover, law's fate as a topic sets up expectations that are themselves contestable. One expectation is that law matters in some important way, and that its fate, whether continuous or discontinuous, matters. Yet, one of the insights offered by many scholars of legal history is that law is generally much less important than we lawyers tend to think. Law neither confines people's behavior nor works as an independent force in history. Another expectation is that one could assess the fate of a cluster of institutions, practices, and ideologies associated with, if not all, human history, then at least with the last several centuries of Western civilization. Advice from historians, sociologists, and anthropologists make me doubt any such assessments freed from my own situated perspective. I am most intrigued by the possibility that to talk about the fate of law is to make explicit what, in another era, may have been so taken for granted that no one needed to speak of or speculate about it. Imagine, for example, someone posing as a topic for a lecture series in 12th century Rome, the fate of religion. Or someone asking, on April 15th of this year, the fate of taxes. As an initial topic, therefore, I ask, why would people, like yourselves, want to hear about the fate of law at this moment? What is going on that could make this seem an interesting or even important subject? Why would intelligent people be wondering, at this moment, about the fate of law? I cannot help but note that, at this moment, we have recently witnessed grand jury investigations of the Attorney General of the United States, televised Senate hearings on the constitutional beliefs of Supreme Court nominees, and a highly publicized criminal trial of a military official who defended his role in a foreign policy scandal as inspired by the president's law or a still higher law. My first conjecture is that, deeper than these current affairs topics, there are a series of legal and political debates that signal shifts in generally accepted assumptions about law and society. Along with the usual controversies over turf and policy, I hear some new arguments that realign old foes and old colleagues into new coalitions and new disagreements. A challenge to the pornography industry joins radical feminists and conservative religious leaders in common cause or collaborations of convenience. Similarly, civil rights activists seeking sanctions for hate speech inspire opposition from some defenders of civil liberties and thus divide long-standing coalitions. Fundamentalist religious groups who oppose secular humanism in public school textbooks find supporters among left-wing critics who challenge the suppression of subgroup identity and group conflict by government officials. Opponents of abortion and advocates for the rights of disabled persons join forces to oppose feminists and others on medical treatment issues for handicapped fetuses and infants. People in very different quarters argue that the law should not constrain them because they listen to a higher law or personal conscience. Interests in community unite people who criticize liberal individualism for the contrasting reasons that traditional authorities need reinforcement and that traditional authorities exclude many from full participating membership. Why are comrades and opponents shifting alignments? I think that traditional assumptions, usually so deep as to seem natural or incontestable, are newly open for discussion. This has happened before. We have named such periods of history the Reformation and the Enlightenment to indicate these sea changes. What I see before us are new debates about rights, about the rule of law, about foundations for belief and the nature of truth, and about the relations between individuals and society. These are standard topics in studies of jurisprudence, studies by prudent and even not-so-prudent jurists. Yet, current debate among scholars, lawyers, and politicians digs deeper into cultural presuppositions than it often has. The debates about these standard topics these days include even what should count as a persuasive argument in the debates themselves. I will speculate first about the shape of recent debates, and then pursue their reverberations in the standard topics of jurisprudence. Finally, I will offer contrasting histories that attend to people both at the margins and at the center of legal theorizing. Sea changes. How do people know when they are living through historic changes in the assumptions that undergird their culture? One clue is the shifts in alignment among groups over issues of the day. Another clue appears in the work of artists who provide some reflections on cultural practices. Claes Oldenburg's sculptural depiction of law in the atrium of the Loyola Law School in Los Angeles perhaps provides such a clue to some tumult in law. His sculpture is a ladder leaning precariously with a can of paint perched on its top rung, the paint splurting out in a moment of frozen disaster. First-year students reportedly find much comfort in this sculptural depiction of their chosen field. But perhaps this image captures the sense of impending disaster experienced by people who turn to law rather than by the law itself. The self-perception of legal scholars that historic shifts are occurring can be gleaned by the metaphor of a fight or battle that commonly appears in descriptions of developments in legal theory over the past decade. In an explicit dispute waged by self-identified contestants, legal scholars have competed over what should count as good work and what the enterprise of legal scholarship should address. Many law schools in the late 1980s either experienced such a fight or discussed the battle at other law schools with concern. Even selecting the terms to describe the fight is a contentious issue. One version of the dispute identifies, on one side, the defenders of rationality. They believe that it is possible and wise to conduct public affairs by identifying goals, devising alternative strategies to achieve those goals, evaluating the costs and benefits and other consequences of those alternatives, and selecting the one that maximizes the achievement of the goals. Theirs is an instrumental rationality, but many who hold this view also believe that ends, as well as means, can be selected through reason. And rational people, after due discussion, should be able to agree. On the other side, according to this view, a disparate crew of challengers criticize the model of rationality for failing to describe the behavior of people under law, and for failing to offer sufficient self-consciousness about the self-interests of legal actors. They emphasize the disagreements in society and the points of view, typically silenced by the lawyer's conclusions about what is sound public policy or reasonable standards of care. They note the disingenuity embedded in an idea like rational consensus, for it either reduces rationality to what all would agree upon, or reduces consensus to the position that some elite group has designated as rational. Attentive to dissent, some critics challenge the model of rationality for disguising the operations of power and the allocation of resources in society. They argue that power and resources fundamentally determine what can and cannot be articulated as a goal to be accomplished by the legal system. Rationality then becomes the label assigned to the views of those who have more power and more privilege. Proponents of this view urge the study of false consciousness and agenda manipulation. They want to unearth suppressed viewpoints and subjugated discourses. Some imply that someday we could produce a genuine version of the kind of inclusive discussion and rational process of persuasion imagined by the rationalists, but only after much else changes. Others maintain that we cannot now know how to imagine relationships between knowledge and power and between reason and politics to posit after such changes, and continuing efforts to do so are simply mistaken efforts to hang on to patterns from the past. Some critics recommend refining analytic techniques to puncture persistent claims to rationality in legal argument. Others urge thick descriptions of the operations of power. Some look to the power of metaphor, imagery, and non-rational modes in the formation of desires and the conveyance of meaning. Still others promote utopian visions and speculations. Perhaps paradoxically or parasitically, explorations of the self-delusions of rationality tend to adopt the standard forms of rational argument. The critics write law review articles, complete with footnotes and step-by-step arguments, and only infrequently depart from this form. Yet they fit materials from poets, rock music, and European social theorists into footnotes. They import into law reviews dialogues, personal anecdotes, and reflections on the law review form. It is not sufficient to fold these innovations back within the traditional forms. The challengers have found numerous and inventive ways to disturb them from within. Organizing the debates in terms of the defenders of reason and its critics is one and one disputable version of the fight. One of its serious defects is the tendency to obscure the variety of challenges offered to traditional legal argument and legal theory. Some among those I have called the challengers reject the very distinction between reason and emotion, or reason and power, as remnants of the categories they seek to combat. Others deny the psychological resonance and moral acceptability of a rationality modeled upon utilitarian cost-benefit analysis and its premise of autonomous individualism. In order to elaborate the beliefs shared by members of a particular community, some investigate the intellectual moves that count as rational within courtrooms and law schools. Some imply a faith in seeking the truth while criticizing what is counted as truth in the past. Some others assault the very goal of seeking the truth as insensitive to the epistemological and political diversity opened up by the challengers. Many emphasize that perceptions and preferences are unavoidably conditioned by local and contingent beliefs and practices, and therefore, no general universal framework of knowledge or persuasion, no science of law, as defended by the rationalists, is possible. Some scholars, lawyers, and political figures seem confused by the conflict. Some simply draw on the challengers' views while working within the rationalist model. Some try to assimilate the challengers to previous categories of thought and cabin their arguments as points of agreement or disagreement with particular legal positions. Others claim that the challengers simply revive old and familiar positions developed by the legal realists in the 1920s or even by the ancient sophists. Some practicing lawyers assume that the challengers are communists. Some political figures try to superimpose national political divisions on the internal law school fights. President Reagan gave a speech celebrating the emergence of the Federalist Society as a response to critical legal studies. But these efforts to order the law school debates according to other frameworks show widespread failures to engage with the debates themselves. If taken seriously, I think that the contemporary debates in legal theory foretell a shift in paradigms, to use Thomas Kuhn's now familiar term. The very familiarity of Kuhn's idea attests to the change. He wrote about how changes in the sciences, and by analogy, in other knowledge-seeking endeavors, are resisted by members of the expert community who are wedded to the prevailing paradigm for seeking and testing knowledge. Yet, anomalies, instances that do not fit, may persist and resist the expert's readiness to explain them away. When many experts begin to notice repeated failures in the paradigm, they may grow more speculative, more theoretical, more willing to debate the ordinary ways of working and understanding so taken for granted when the paradigm seemed to work. Talk of paradigms and paradigm shifts echoes throughout universities, businesses, and even the popular press. News stories describe minority viewpoints as anomalies that test prevailing paradigms. A satiric comic sings the song, "Brother, can you paradigm?" If taken seriously, the debates between rationalists and challengers in legal scholarship could shed light on developments in legal practice. In many ways, practicing lawyers have even more corrosive skepticism about rational consensus as a way to explain law than do legal scholars. It is lawyers, after all, who acknowledge that judges do not act according to universally shared reason, but according to their own political and personal preferences. Lawyers use every available research technique to discover what has mattered to a particular judge in the past in order to produce a persuasive argument in the future. It is lawyers who presume the irrationality of juries, while believing in their own abilities to predict or manipulate jury behavior. The law firm representing MCI staged mock trials before juries who were selected to match, by demographic characteristics, the members of the actual jury in a suit against AT&T. By testing alternative theories and methods of presentation before the mock juries, the lawyers selected the arguments most likely to succeed for their clients, and thus fed the results of their studies back into the system. Some lawyers are joined by scholars in looking at the ways that ostensible challenges to power in the name of rationality become ever more subtle extensions of it. Critics of alternative dispute resolution, mediation, arbitration, and the like have explored this route, as have some observers of the medical profession. These critics document how the established profession tends to absorb the profession's pockets of resistance and thereby confirm that the profession's monopoly rather than allow some competition. Thus, some hospitals include midwives in their medical team for childbirth. Some adopt acupuncture as part of a medical management of pain. Courts and law firms have embraced mediation and brought it under their roofs, rather than allowing it a separate path as an alternative to the formal system. Critics, including legal scholars, legal services attorneys, and other public interest lawyers, have expressed greater reservations about the new dispute resolution techniques and cautions about new packages for poor people's justice. For me, the seriousness of changes in law, and the sense that the ocean is shifting even as we stand here, hit home in discussions during the past 2 years among women lawyers about pregnancy and maternity leave benefits. This issue sharply divided people who usually vigorously work together in law reform efforts. The problem emerged from a clash between federal and state laws. In two memorable federal cases, the Supreme Court rejected constitutional and statutory challenges to private employers' decisions to exclude pregnancy benefits from health care. The court reasoned that the employer did not draw a forbidden distinction on the basis of sex, only one on the basis of pregnancy. Since women could be both pregnant and non-pregnant, this was not an instance of sex discrimination. With this auspicious beginning, perhaps it is a good development that litigation on related issues proceeded on statutory rather than constitutional grounds. When the court interprets statutes, its judgments can be more quickly overturned by legislatures than when the court construes the Constitution, for then only the slow and complex process of constitutional amendment remains as an avenue for correction. Indeed, Congress responded to the court's statutory ruling by enacting a statute, the Pregnancy Discrimination Act, that bans discrimination on the basis of pregnancy, as well as any other impermissible sex discrimination. But now, if differentiation on the basis of pregnancy is forbidden, does this mean that states may not require pregnancy or maternity leaves, a distinction or discrimination that helps women? Litigation over this issue culminated in a recent decision by the Supreme Court. The court considered whether the Pregnancy Discrimination Act itself forbids even favorable treatment on the basis of pregnancy. Does the requirement of non-discrimination mandate the same treatment, or does it permit special treatment? Advocates for women's rights argued about this with a kind of intensity and distress that helped me understand why brothers could fight brothers in the American Civil War. Writing briefs on opposing sides of the case, women's rights groups went public with the division. At a meeting in Washington, D.C., in the fall of 1987, opponents within the community of women's rights advocates met to discuss our differences. Some maintained that any distinction on the basis of pregnancy, any distinction on the basis of sex, would perpetuate negative stereotypes and the denigration and exclusion of women. Others argued that denying the facts of pregnancy and the needs of new mothers could only hurt women. Treating women like men in the workplace violated the demands of equality. Can equality be secured through similar or through different treatment? Importantly, many advocates for women agreed that the workplace itself was the problem, because employers had the traditional male employee in mind as the model worker, with a full-time wife, mother at home. The very phrase special treatment, when used to describe pregnancy or maternity leave, treats men as the norm and women as different or deviant from that norm. None of the advocates for women's rights accepted this male-centered view. In this sense, we are divided merely over the tactic to be used to alter the relationship between work and family. Well, not entirely. The division among advocates for women plunged deeper than mere tactics in at least two respects. First, we disagreed about what goal we actually sought. Pregnancy and maternity leaves, more flexibility in work hours to accommodate demands of any dependents at home, or even more flexibility in work hours for whatever reason a worker wanted. Second, we differed over how much to accept and agree within prevailing frameworks of analysis versus how much to challenge those frameworks directly. Some who wanted this larger challenge acknowledged the risks of losing, but stated that we should not seek only what we could win. There is more at stake in our strategy than winning. There is the matter of symbolic expression and resistance. In these respects, the disagreements begin to suggest the larger debates about law and the stakes of those debates, including assaults on the modes for seeking change designated by the legal system itself. One of the most contentious disputes among us involved whether we should rest simply with the divisions expressed within the group of articulate, well-educated, and relatively powerful advocates for women's rights, or instead go and seek out perspectives of women in rural and distant communities who had even less access to courts, legislatures, and instruments of power. Were we engaging in exclusionary practices of the very sort we rallied to oppose? Was it really our domain to try to determine leave policy, or would a more democratic procedure, one that assures equality in the right to decide, design a process for more women or all women in the country to answer the issue? We did not answer this question, and we disagreed about its importance as well. Instead, we fought over what arguments advocated in the room we should endorse. One inventive group argued for retaining the language of sameness as the predicate for equal treatment, while urging the court to preserve pregnancy and maternity leaves by calling for comparable benefits for men. To the surprise of many of us, this is the approach that later convinced the court. The majority opinion, written by Justice Thurgood Marshall, said that the correct question is not whether the ban against pregnancy discrimination also forbids special accommodation, but, instead, whether a workplace rule satisfies the ban against pregnancy discrimination if it allows both men and women to combine work and family. It is a temporary resolution, however, for the decision was ambiguous about whether employers can, or must, provide comparable benefits for men or for non-pregnant employees. Legislators and lobbyists are now similarly embattled on these issues. Many observers predict that employers will simply hire fewer women, or communicate that employees who actually elect to take the leaves will lose out on the job in the long run. According to others, the very process of trying to predict consequences is a waste because any reform will ultimately hurt women until women's power in society increases generally. Advocates for further change argue that pregnancy is a social issue, not a women's problem. Still others dispute the very idea that women represents a meaningful or coherent group with shared interests and emphasize differences of race, class, and religion that make it difficult to talk of what is good for women. A similar conflict occupies discussions of comparable worth. Through lawsuits and other legal initiatives, reformers seek to rectify inequities in pay based on gender segregation in the workplace and to revalue traditional women's work that the marketplace has devalued. They ask, why should secretaries receive lower pay than truck drivers? Why should telephone operators receive lower compensation than telephone salespeople? Reason, claim the proponents of comparable worth, can be used to expose the prejudices that have both confined women to particular jobs and underpaid them. Reason can guide reevaluations of the social contribution made by different kinds of work. Advocates of comparable worth claim that it is possible to assess the relative value of a given job skill and line up the valuation of jobs on this basis. Its opponents object that comparable worth requires comparing apples and oranges and departs from the one objective source of measurement, the marketplace. Thus far, we seem to have a contest over whether the marketplace is rational and over whether other sources of reasoned evaluation can be as or more reliable. The divisions of views quickly becomes more complicated. Some advocates for women support the idea behind comparable worth, but object that any measure of the value of a given job skill will ultimately draw on the market value of that job, and thus revalidate the market's devaluation of traditional women's work while making the gender-based critique more elusive. Thus, these critics would argue, if comparable worth analysis uses the new industry of job evaluators, the new doctrine may simply cloak the persistent undervaluation of such skills as taking care of people, handling paperwork, and managing interpersonal dynamics in the guise of objective and positive social science. Moreover, they would claim, we have no benchmarks, accessible through reason, that are free from patterns of discrimination. This position is likely to invite the rejoinder. On what foundation can you base your assertions of discrimination if there is no rational corrective to the undervaluation of women's jobs? Perhaps it is this worry that leads others to urge a broadly based challenge to divisions of job responsibilities, such as the distinction between nurses and doctors. Nothing short of major social reconstruction according to a blueprint not yet written, will do. Still, other advocates for women stop far short of calling for revolution. Instead, they oppose comparable worth or other alternatives on the grounds that they would deter women from seeking more challenging and more rewarding roles offered in traditional male jobs. In this view, women should aspire to be doctors, not better-paid nurses. The most recent retort to this claim is that if many women become doctors, then the work of doctors, too, will become devalued. We cannot reason our way out of existing patterns of power relationships and images of gender. Our very efforts to reason about them may lead us, mistakenly, to exacerbate the problems. Each of these examples suggests deep conflicts within groups seeking to change social and legal practices. Such conflicts may be the predictable side effects of reform activities. Torn even in small decisions over legal tactics by the old debate over reform versus revolution, and splintered by repeated political losses and the frustrating search for toeholds in the existing systems, reformers throughout history have often had more divisive debates among themselves than with their ostensible foes. Yet, I sense that the divisions that I have heard within reform camps expose profound conflicts over what law is or could be. Should we construct society according to categories that distinguish between what is natural and what is socially constructed and therefore subject to change? What counts as truth and what counts as illusion in legal argument? What relationships between individuals and society are possible or desirable? Any of the questions may divide those who believe that existing methods of rational argument afford methods to formulate goals and achieve them, and those who believe that our very tools of reason and proof encode the problems we seek to tackle. The latter group argues that we reproduce the problems rather than disentangle ourselves from them in the rationalist legal alternatives we debate. The conflicts manifested by debates among reformers are matched, these days, by the tensions among traditionalists who confront a world more fluid and volatile than they would choose. Let me couple these glimpses of how reformers experience and express the shifting paradigms with an equally brief suggestion of what traditionalists may be feeling. I use as examples an evaluation of the practices of the former Solicitor General of the United States and current law school debates over law school curriculum planning. A recent book by a journalist, Lincoln Kaplan, criticizes the former Solicitor General of the United States, Charles Freed, for politicizing the office of the nation's lawyer before the Supreme Court. In The Tenth Justice, 1987, Kaplan details the manner in which many distinguished lawyers who have held the office of Solicitor General built up, through the decades, a reputation for integrity, neutrality, and excellence in legal analysis and judgment before the Supreme Court. The Solicitor General has served in many ways as a judge as well as an advocate, screening the cases that various agencies of the federal government had lost in lower courts and deciding which to take to the Supreme Court. In addition, the Solicitor General has played a powerful role as friend of the court, amicus curiae.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.